Every I has been dotted, every T has been crossed. You can't add one more thing. Someone said, well, the Bible says faith without works is dead. And that's true. But the word works there means a corresponding deed that reflects our faith. In other words, if I believe that electricity is flowing through this building tonight, I'll walk over to the light switch and I'll flip a switch. It doesn't mean that, well, because I want to be pleasing to God, I'll do something. No, it means that if I take God at his word, the good news that is really sounds too good to be true, but it's true, then my works will be, I'll take that by faith, even though it doesn't make sense. I'll receive the substitution of his sacrifice, his payment, his penalty for my sins, so that I can become the righteousness of God in Christ. If you see that, and toward the end of the service, I'll lead you in a prayer that way. If you pray that prayer, I want you to understand that that's a spiritual transaction that takes place. It's not joining something. It's not turning over a new leaf. It's a spiritual transaction where the Spirit of God puts you into the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, just as Isaiah prophesied about. He'll heal you, spirit, soul, mind, and body. And I want to let you know tonight, whatever struggle, burden, hurt, wound, situation of life that you may think that God is not aware of, he's so very well aware, because the Bible says he is touched with the feelings of our infirmities. So before we begin tonight, and at the end of my prayer, we will begin the presentation, I'm going to pray a blessing over you and a prayer over you. That if there's a burden of your heart, if you felt hopeless, if you're battling depression, if there's pain in your body, that through the course of the evening, you'll experience the healing touch of Calvary, because God loves you more than you could ever imagine. Father, I do that right now. By faith, I declare that there's no one inconsequential. There are no big I's, no little U's that are here tonight. Everyone is important to you. And you're not just far off, a concept and a thought, but by your presence and your spirit, you're here right now. And I thank you that as we enjoy and we observe what you did for us 2,000 years ago, that the efficacy of every stripe, the pain that you went through, that we'll employ it and we'll draw upon it by faith and make it our own. And when the mind says this doesn't make sense, we remember it's the gospel, it is the good news. It's too good to be true, but it is true. And by faith we'll accept it. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you give Christ a clap of praise because he's worthy?
Oh, This has gotten out of hand. Do you hear the things they're shouting?
Just said.
He did.
And Jesus told him, I don't. These men testify against you. You said you would destroy the temple and build it again in 3 days. What is your defense? Do you not have an answer? I adjure you by the living God. Tell us if you are the Son of God.
I am. And one day you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the Mighty One, coming in the clouds of heaven.
We shall see you seated at the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven? Blasphemy! What other witnesses do we need? We need no further testimony.
Prophesy to us, Christ.
What is your judgment?
Death!
Take him to Pilate.
These men say that you have been misleading the people by prohibiting them from paying tribute to Caesar. They say you are Christ, a king. Are you the king of the Jews?
Yes, it is as you say.
He incites dissension.
He stirs up the people.
Do you hear the testimony of these men? I find no fault in this man. If he is Galilean, then take him to Herod.
This was the reason I was born.
find no fault in this man. Your king wears a crown of thorns. I've had him flogged to the point of death. Isn't this enough?
Please, have nothing to do with this innocent man. I have suffered a great deal in a dream today because of him.
I wash my hands of this righteous man's blood. You have a custom in observance of Passover that I free one prisoner. Whom would you have me to free? Barabbas the robber or Jesus the Christ?
Barabbas!
And what would you have me to do with Jesus?
Crucify!
Why? Why? What crime has he committed? Very well. Crucify your king, but his blood be upon your hands. Away with your king.
the bed of death that they prepare now. The angels weep, Satan laughs, his revelry has come at last. Though he ignores the epitaph inscribed in stone upon the tomb
that spells his sleeper's victory.
Ever hope to match the one and only
Jesus was struggling to breathe. We knew the end was near. Suddenly, he cried out in a loud voice, "It is finished!" The sky turned black as night, and the earth shook like it was being split apart. People were running, screaming, falling. Then others started shouting, "The veil! The veil has been torn!" I ran to the temple. I had to see it for myself. The veil that had hidden the Holy of Holies. The veil that had separated God's presence for nearly 1,500 years, torn from top to bottom by the hand of God. No more sins to sacrifice. Jesus is the Lamb of God. I missed him already. It was hard to believe he was really gone. It is over. My Lord was dead.
I was
put my fingers into the nail prints in his hands, I will not believe. A week or so later, we all met together. It was night, and all the doors in the house had been shut and locked securely, for fear the soldiers would be after us also.
Really? Who?
I know that Cleopas was one of them. He said they're on their way back from on their way to Jerusalem, and they were talking about everything that had happened here over the last 2 weeks. And it wasn't until they were eating supper that... Thomas! It's Jesus! He's looking at you! He's holding out his hands to you!
Yeah.
there's not a cheaper sinner present tonight than me. Not that I'm practicing sin right now. I'm living close to God. But I know what God's brought me from. I know what I used to be. Started drinking at the age of 12, doing drugs at the age of 12. And I've said so many times, if I was God, I wouldn't have called me to have been a pastor. I'd have found somebody that had it more together and less baggage and so forth. But for whatever reason, before I was born, he called me. And he used all those years that I ran from God, that I was bound by things that a lot of people that come to church are bound with and think that nobody understands. And if it makes somebody feel more comfortable to know that a pastor understands, let me also let you know that there's a Savior that understands. Because the Bible says he was tempted in all points like you and I are, yet without sin. And at 53 years of age, I've come to the point that you're looking at the weakest strong man you'll ever see and the strongest weak man you'll ever see. I've learned to give my weaknesses to God and say, I don't need to be my own Savior. I need to use him as a crutch and confess to him every day, Father God, I'm a cripple. I lean upon your promises. I lean upon your blood. And I make you my strength. So nowadays, when I'm counseled with somebody, they say, but you don't understand, Pastor Grady, I'm bound by drugs. I'd say, yeah, I do understand. But more importantly, that cross understands. Because every sin you ever would commit, he nailed them there. He left them there, and he wants you to leave them there. All the enemy was around when you did all of your the way that you used to live. He remembers. But isn't it interesting that God's got a bad memory? Because when you committed it to the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, he washes it away, and it's never remembered against you again. Is someone here tonight struggling with things that you just can't get settled? It might be anger. It might be bitterness. It might be unforgiveness. It might be alcohol. It might be drugs. It might be pornography. It might be any number of things. You'll never find Jesus pointing a finger. Never. And saying, shame on you. He'll point you back to the cross and say, I knew what you were capable of. I made you weak. I made you fallible. So that you would learn to look to me to be everything that you need me to be. I'm a healer. I'm a savior. I can cleanse you. I can break bondages. I can restore broken hearts, broken lives, broken souls, broken homes and families and hearts. He can do it all, and he did it 2,000 years ago. I'm going to pray a prayer over you right now. And I'm going to ask everyone to pray a prayer out loud, and then I'm going to pray a pastoral blessing over you. And I believe we're a Pentecostal church. We're a charismatic church. We believe that the God that said what he was 2,000 years ago hasn't changed, migrated, mutated, or anything. He's still the same today. And if Jesus was walking in here tonight, and he is by his spirit, and he would look at anybody that has a malady, he wouldn't say to any, you know, I used to heal, but I decided that's no longer needed. He would look at every person that has a need, and he'd say to us unequivocally, I would. I won't patch you up. I'll make you whole. Would you pray a prayer with me, one and all? If you pray that prayer tonight to receive Christ as Lord and to let him be your strength in your weakness, it doesn't mean turn over a new leaf. It means let him be your strength. If you would like to, there are pew Bibles in front of you. And I'd like for you, if you pray that prayer, you don't have a Bible, I'd like for you to take one of those Bibles home and go to the Gospel of John tonight and begin to read how much God loves you, because he really does. I'm going to ask the cast, everybody that's here, everyone, to pray this prayer out loud. And if you pray it by faith, let him love you with his cross tonight. Would you do that? Lord God, you sent your Son, just for me. When I was yet unlovable, dead in my trespasses and sins, Jesus looked down through eternity and saw me in need of a Savior and said, I will be your answer. I will love you with my cross. I leave my sins there and have the judgment of God upon my sins. And by faith, I receive your forgiveness and your healing for my spirit, soul, mind, and body. You're a God of restoration. I receive that anointing upon my life. And right now, I'm your child. I have eternal life, and I'm ready to see you. Amen and amen. Father, I pray the blessing over one and all in the name of the Lord Jesus. I release an anointing upon every home, every circumstance, and every situation. I pray over anyone struggling with depression, oh God, as I understand how deep and dark that can be. And I believe and declare over them tonight, arise and shine, for your light is coming. The glory of the Lord is rising upon you. I speak hope where there's hopelessness, healing to hearts, homes, and families. In Jesus' name, and everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Give Jesus one more clap offering. You know, I'm going to ask someone to get all of these lights, and I'm going to ask the usher to come forward and give us an opportunity to invest in this production tonight. You're under no compunction to do so, but if you would like to, you can plant an offering, and that will bless their efforts and all the time and energy that they've placed into it. And ushers, if you'd come on forward, I'm going to let Mary Gates say a final word to you, and then we'll let you go in just a minute. Mary Gates. And let me say that we have put our daughter, Caitlin, through torment the last two nights. We've been doing this 30 years, and I know we don't look that old. She certainly isn't. But she ran sound the last two nights. It's the best sound that I've ever heard in 30 years. She's probably getting off all of her fingernails, but she did not think it was.
Thank you all for coming tonight. I pray that this good news, the greatest story ever told, bless your heart tonight. Were you blessed? Would you help me thank this entire cast up here for their hard work and their dedication to the gospel? Thank you.
I sent out in my tweets, and you can check my tweets at church right now on Twitter. Subscribe if you want to, or check out our website at lifeinchicago.org, lifeinchicago.org. But we're not competing with any churches except in one thing. We're going to be the absolute best in loving people the way Jesus loves people. So this is our doxology around here at Life Church, and you're going to get me started, and the whole choir is going to help.
I just called to say I love you. I just called to say how much I care. I just called to say I love you. And I'm here from the bottom of my heart.
Well, listen, white folk don't know how to do this. Y'all look like you were enduring this. We're going to do it one more time. Come on, everybody, of every nationality, come on, and then I'll let you be dismissed. Some of y'all are looking at me like you would throw a songbook at me. Don't do it. We don't have a songbook. But let's do it one more time, then I'll let you be dismissed. And when you do it, smile to somebody and say, you are looking wonderful tonight for a change. Would you do that? Let's do this. Come on. I just...
Thank you.
What'd you think?
Okay, okay.